This podcast is made possible by McDSP, makers of the award-winning APB16 and APB8 hardware and professional audio plugins. Learn more at mcdsp.com.
Hey, it's Larry Crane. Welcome to the Tape Op Podcast. For this episode, we are joined by Toronto's Alvvays and producer-mixer Shawn Everett to chat about crafting their latest release, Blue Rev, a project that spanned months of home recordings in Canada, sessions with Shawn in Los Angeles, file-sharing snafus, and more. Enjoy.
All right, we can start without him as well, and then bring him in. Are you guys in your own space? You have your studio there?
This is the basement of the apartment we've rented for the last 12 years. Yeah. But yeah, this is kind of where we jam a bit. Molly and I with drum machines mainly. We have another little shed that we also rent, which is where we do the loud stuff. I think Owen Pallett used to rent that same spot, but they're very humble in scope. We've got our 388 here, but might move it to the shed pretty soon.
Yeah, no, so are you guys recording, doing pre-production and just demos there, and then kind of stepping out and reimagining things in the studio as a whole? I know that that's not the case for the whole record.
Yeah, we do, you know, it's a sort of continuous flow with the tracking, like what is a demo, and, you know, the continuum isn't as delineated as it once was, because, you know, once you start getting a preamp or two, you can start to keep stuff, and the bones of the demos become the songs, like the arrangements, like 9 times out of 10 are there already. It's rare we have to change tempo or anything like that, or we've gotten somewhat competent at tracking.
You never know, you play it one time and it never feels the same again, and that's what it is, whether or not it's great or recorded well or not. I mean, sometimes it doesn't even matter, it's just sort of the feeling of it is there. And
totally. And our ineptitude also works against us in that scenario as well, because if we do stumble on something, a better competent engineer could probably get back there, or at least kind of close, but we're just banging rocks together, you know, trying to make fire.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, I feel like sometimes that naivety of in the recording space, I mean, we're so caught up in this, you know, so much focus is put on this technical aspect of making music, and I feel like it's a lot of it is what's ignored is that so much music is made and that has been sort of revered and loved and endured was made, you know, with either by people that didn't really know what they were doing, or B, with, you know, sort of quote subpar non, you know, super high end gear or guitars or, you know, cheap amps, cheap microphones. I mean, I can think Absolutely. Of 100 examples Yeah. of things that just, it just doesn't matter as long as the sort of emotional content is there, you know?
It's not true. People will cast aside fidelity for good ideas, you know, or like overlook the lackluster, you know, quality of something if it's a good song, I think. I mean, I do. All the stuff I listen to sounds horrible.
For example?
I don't know. Like, I mean, if I were to listen to like a Cleaners from Venus song, and I actually thought about the way it sounded, it would probably be really distracting. But the melodies and the ideas behind it are just, they hypnotize me and I don't think about it. And sometimes you just notice when something comes on afterwards that's a really modern recording or something that is just sort of flawless technically, but you know, I really don't notice otherwise when things are crunchy or.
Yeah. There's, I don't know. It reads as authenticity a lot of the times, I guess, if you hear something that's like visibly or audibly weathered and sort of amateur sounding. And what you lose in technical, you know, the frequency spectrum, I guess, you gain in like, in that, you know, realness, I guess. You know, I like pristine sounded stuff as much as anyone too, like the Free Design or something. Mind you, that was pristine in 65 or something, so probably, you know, definitely mid-fi by today's standards. But yeah, like Dolly Mixture, those, it's tough to tell what's a demo, what's a real song with those guys. Yeah, like R. Stevie Moore, just kind of like super, loads of artifacts and tape. And that's kind of the point, but also, you know, all those people had to work with, and it ends up better for it.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, and there's something to that. You mentioned R. Stevie Moore. There's a lot of records that have this real homemade bedroom quality to them that feel so much more intimate and personal. And they, you know, like they had the freedom to be themselves without somebody looking over their shoulder or through a piece of glass or criticizing. Or there he is.
Hello.
John.
Good morning.
I'm so sorry.
Oh, it's okay. And not only did you get a mic, but you put up a 87 or a 67. So that's, thank you.
Yeah, we got full blast mics now.
Yeah, we're good. You're gonna have to swap your mics out, because this is, you know, the
blown us away.
Brought a bazooka to a knife fight.
So sorry. I'm late. I'm my daughter's first day of school, and I woke up at 7:30, but I went to bed at 4:30, so I was like,
"You're trash."
Nap city at the moment.
It's all working. We were just talking about, and when we can pivot from here, but we were just, you dropped in on a parachuted in on a conversation about just the virtues of capturing emotional content rather than having everything be hi-fi, and that,
oh sweet,
that was not in relationship to Blue Rev or the record that you guys made. Although there are some qualities to this record that are very, like, the first thing that I thought of when I put your record on was it reminded me of records that I loved from like Ride and the Catherine Wheel and Lush, and like just a sort of a different era. This was like a little bit washy, a little bit shimmery, and just great melodies. And I felt like it was all those things from those records of a little bit of a different era, to be honest, that I really loved. And it seems like this has a little bit of a backstory in terms of the, before you actually got into the studio together to make this record with Shawn. And that included the pandemic in the mix on at that timeline. So, you know, either of you care to kind of just give the backstory and the setup to getting to where you guys made this record together?
I guess, like, yeah, we're always writing and demoing around the clock. And there were a lot of curveballs. We did start to record the record, and then the pandemic happened. So we were, you know, sprinting through the airport trying to get back to Canada.
Yeah, we were in Seattle when it went down, when we had to get out of Dodge, and we had time booked at Sunset Sound. But we had to kibosh that the day after the NBA canceled its events.
Yeah. If I don't know, if it didn't happen, I feel like we wouldn't have had this time with Shawn. And like we're pretty surprised when you agreed to work with us.
Oh, I saw right as you said that I dropped my phone, and so all of you came crashing down. I mean, I was surprised you asked me my actually. I was like, hell yeah, always exactly what I wanted to be doing. Amazing.
I mean, do you regret it though?
Not at all. That was like one of the best experiences ever.
Well, how did you guys come together?
We have basically a phone call where we all talked for an hour.
Yes.
We talked about the Moffats and other obscure 90s Canadian.
It was cool because like I've been now living in the States for like 18 years. I didn't realize how thirsty I was to like talk to some Canadians that grew up in like a quasi similar era as me, and just be able to talk about like pop cultural references that like nobody here knows about. I can't really bring up Mother Earth with my wife, and she doesn't really get the reference point. So as soon as I was talking to them, I was like, this is like amazing vibe to be able to talk to people about this stuff. I mean, I also have loved their band since they came out. So, I mean, there was a double doozy.
What attracted you to working with Shawn or wanting to reach out to him?
Well, Shawn has such an eclectic resume. Like, you've done, I feel like, everything, but, you know, from huge pop to, like, War on Drugs, which is really almost, like, experimental in a way to me, like, the way some of that stuff is recorded and mixed together, and all the drum machine stuff on those recordings, I thought it was so cool. And also, I just feel like you have such a great grasp of expanding soundscapes, if that
makes
sense.
Thanks, Molly. Thank you.
I don't know.
There were Casey Musgrave's record, that mix as well was pretty wild. Was it Golden Hour? Is that the record?
Yeah.
Yeah. That sounded immaculate.
That small record.
Well, thanks for hiring me, guys. It was the time of my life.
We did. I think our previous manager, we asked him if we could work with you on our second record. But I think we got shunted elsewhere. All's well.
Gossip.
I don't know where the shunt came from. Wasn't my shunt.
Not my shunt.
So you ended up recording this record down in Los Angeles, correct?
Yeah, and we brought everything that we had done previous to getting there. So it was like a gigantic stew of ideas and recordings that I just kept morphing over time. And a lot of the live off-the-floor stuff is from Shawn's warehouse.
Yeah, we were chomping at the bit, and Sheridan and Abby couldn't come to Canada legally at the point we wanted to record, so we did some tracking with Chris Dadge, who has drummed on our other two records. He's from Calgary, like Shawn, and so we recorded at Canterbury Studios in downtown Toronto, and that was with our ex-manager Robbie Lakritz.
Love Robbie.
Yeah, great guy. Then we went to the Bath House, which is the Tragically Hip, another CanCon heavy. It's their studio that they run in Kingston, Ontario. So we had a few, you know, bones to draw upon in addition to what we had recorded in the basement and the shed when we went down to L.A.
I believe some of what I read, but I read that you guys had like basically set up and played this thing live. It said was you played this record back to back twice or something like that. And how did that work with, you know, your existing, you know, frameworks?
John, do you want to describe where this idea came from and how it worked?
Well,
everything in.
They were here, I can't remember. I can't remember. People had to leave. I think the two of you were good, but we didn't have much time with the full band. I was a little bit panicking because I needed to get as much material as I possibly could in the amount of time that we had to record. I was just trying to think of how to like rapid fire get information. They had all the demos. I just took all the demos and made basically like stems of everything that they had in their demos. And then what I did was I had like, I can't remember, maybe five stems per song. And I just put them all in like the same Pro Tools session. And then with their like beep, actually like a click was part of the stem, I think. And so then I just put them all in the same Pro Tools session. And so it was like almost like you could like listen to the whole album in a row of stems. And then I just fired those out into headphones. And so they had, so everybody had like the ability to mix their own version of the demo. And then by doing it that way, it was like, it was just like I was piping down the stems to everybody in like real time and only putting like a small amount of space between each song. And then that way, you know how like if people are, you know, rehearsing, inevitably there's going to be like a conversation or like there's just going to be something happen, which is all like going to just eat up precious time. You know, someone might like flub a note or something like that. There'd be like a conversation about it. And I was like, I don't think we can have a conversation about it right now. We need to like go. And so like by just firing down these stems, like there was like, it was like a freight train and there was like no stopping it. Like there was no, you know, no matter what was going on, the next click was going to start. And so that way we were able to like just get lots of information really quickly. But the other thing that was kind of cool is that after, I don't think it was exactly two takes. There was maybe like three or maybe four, but I was able to change the miking situation between each performance, which was also kind of cool because you could generate like different sonic information at the same time. And so when all the performances had been captured, not only like did you have like different performance information, which is like really exciting because it was almost like you're grabbing it from like a live show where people were kind of on edge, but also there was different sonic information between each of the takes because of you know, just by the nature of recording it differently each one. So you could kind of blend different sonic information with each, you know, with the itself.
Yeah, we thematically could like tailor the sets to like, okay guys, this is the quiet set, so grab the chopsticks and do your thing. Or we would, you know, say, okay, we want to try mucking around with very speed, so let's drop the pitch and tempo of this song by, you know, what X amount, and then with the intent of speeding it back up to get that glassy Lindsey Buckingham sort of effect later on. So in the set there'd be two or three like sludgy sort of takes of the same songs, and that all got put in the cauldron by Sean, and he would slap his witch's hat on and get stirring.
It was cool too because it was also already tied into like the information that they'd already recorded. They had all this cool stuff in the, you know, recordings that they already made, so it was already, you know, being played with that. It was just like there was like a lot of options when that was all recorded because, you know, you had basically I just took all of the takes of every song and I just put them all in the same session on top of each other, so you could mute in and out of different takes of guitars and sounds and stuff like that. So it was just this huge wall of information and you could use pieces of each, you know, whatever you wanted from it. I was like really excited. I'd never actually done that with anybody because most of the time people can't play their albums, but so that was like a bonus. When they told me that they could play the album, I was like, are you serious? I mean, I'm not used to a band being able to play their album. I mean, most of the time people come in and they, you know, or like I have like a sliver of a melody. They can't like just rip their album, you know. That was like blew my mind.
was there anything specific that you did in terms of the setup? I mean, I know what I know about you, Shawn, not only because we've interviewed you before, but, you know, which, I mean, one of the things I just heard Alec say was, you know, you get the chopsticks out. I know that you create crazy kits and, like, you know, you're creating a world for people to sort of exist within.
I mean, I definitely each recording had a different kind of unique sonic vibe. There was, I think, a version that was maybe all contact mics, where the whole kit was contact mics. Yeah, because I did have like a kind of love affair with this hi-hat contact mic that maybe I alone loved. It was like,
we all have those like on this record, I think. It sounded solo like, persists.
Yeah, static. yeah, it was like my I had an affection for this one sound.
Those were great. Those Zeppelin contact mics. That
they were awesome.
Yeah, they worked out.
Definitely, like with someone like Nate Smith. I mean, with like a recording with him, there's like, you know, the albums that I've done with him, I have him for like longer periods of time than like, you know, a few days. So it, you know, it, with that amount of time, you can like actually like make a whole drum kit for one song, yeah, I mean, there is like a bit of a sadistic part of me where it's like, you, when you have like this drummer that's like one of the best of all time, and like, you know, giving him like a like this like this like something from the MoMA to play on, you know, it's just like it's like a kind of secretly funny to me a little bit, you know, just like
it's not secret. It's not secret anymore.
I just think it's kind of funny. I recorded something with him not that long ago, and my dad's a drummer, and he loves like drum tones, and he loves like talking about drums and stuff, and you know, he like really has like a great knowledge of that. And I was playing this recording for him, and he was like, "What is that drum kit?" You know, and I was like, "It's trash," and like it was like just all trash, like everything in the drum kit was trash. Like I just went to the dumpster, and it was just trash, like all trash cans and just total trash. And he was like, I think he was disturbed, but also saddened by like that, like people were buying like $10,000 snare drums, and like we were getting a cool sound out of just total trash. it was a Nate Smith one.
Yeah.
In any case, I tried to do that as much as possible during that like super, super recording. But I mean, that was definitely like flying by the seat of my pants. And I mean, everybody's pants really, cause it was like, you know, basically a live show.
Yeah.
And also like, we're never really in a comfort zone. We're all fairly neurotic. So I feel like it was pretty, maybe even unintentionally intuitive to do that to us. To put all of the songs back to back with like 15 seconds in between, we had no time to be nervous or to overthink anything. I think it was like a really cool mental exercise for all of the freaks in our band who just like psych each other out.
Yeah,
everywhere we go, you know?
We're more comfortable when we're uncomfortable, artificially, I guess.
Yeah, I love that concept. I mean, you just you got to just keep going, you know.
Yeah, and also, if you're doing like, you know, the very speed thing, like you're a drummer, you can attempt all these fills that you wouldn't at 175 BPM necessarily, or like, and that goes for guitar playing too, you know, if it's a kind of ramshackle tune that's like, you know, firing on all cylinders, if all of a sudden it's at, you know, 20 BPM slower, you can like pull off some pretty hot ones.
Shawn, were there... And you touched on a little bit of this, but were there, you know, what were the inherent challenges of trying to get this done?
I mean, normally the challenges would be just to get like a band to be able to do it. You know, I mean, most people would say that this is a bad idea. I've actually like brought this up a few times since then, because I was like, this was so sick. Like, I want to try this again. And like, I've like just mentioned it to other people, and they were like, oh no, no, like no. Like, it's like people are very uncomfortable with the concept. And so like, it was pretty amazing that they were, you know, willing participants of doing it, you know, and I just think that, like, I mean, it was maybe mildly technically challenging just to figure out like how to get, you know, it was like going to tape and we were doing songs at the, you know, Alec mentioned the different like tape speeds and like, what was it, you know, different like tempo, like the songs were, you know, some were slower, just figuring out that math and all, you know, all that stuff, you know, just, and like getting it all in line so that there was the right amount of spacing in between each song so that like they had a second to, you know, grab a drink, but like not, you know, not enough to have a conversation, you know, all those kind of things. But then I just thought that like when we were listening back to the takes afterwards, there was just like such a kind of raw edge to it. And like, it was just a power and like an excitement and like, and the drums fills, even in the, just the normal tempos, were just like, I think a little bit more unhinged in a way that I was like really excited about. I just thought it sounded so sick, you know, cause like if someone's doing a drum take, generally they feel like all eyes are on them. And like, I mean, just coming from my own perspective of having done, you know, drum takes in studios before, it's, you know, stressful. And I think maybe I've been like, whenever I was doing that, I was definitely like a little bit more conservative about what I play. So I just definitely thought that the energy was really cool.
Yeah. Sheridan ripped.
Yeah. Sheridan was blowing my mind. Like, she was doing the sickest fills.
When it came time to mix this, what was that process like?
Well, I mean, there was a lot of other stuff that happened after those recordings. Like, we did a comp of all those things, you know, and started to get a framework of something. And then, you know, these guys would take the sessions to Toronto and they would work on those. And, you know, they'd switch out parts from other, you know, performances as well. And then they would send them back to me. There was also like some kind of haunting of an audio file haunting. For some reason, I've never had a project before where there's just migrating audio files as much as I don't know what was going on. There was a ghost that was like keeping audio files in their purse. Every time I was like, send a session, I'd be like, all right, we got it this time. And it'd be like, oh, there's 7 audio files. I'm like, God damn it. Where are they?
Yeah. I'd have to write back. Pro Tools wants a Macintosh HD /snares. I think that's in your parent folder.
Yeah. No matter how long we would work on the album, there would still be another file that would somehow migrate. But, yeah, they would work on it, then they would send it back to me, and then we'd play around, and then they would come back here, and then, you know, they would, you know, it was just like, there was like a long kind of process of kind of whittling it down. And then eventually that was eventually mixed. Yeah. In 2 days.
Yeah, we all-nightered. Yeah. That was...
There's a long enough time has gone by where I don't need to curl up into the fetal position. Think about those days that we spent together.
Yeah, it was Carrie's first all-nighter. She had never stayed up all night before. Our keyboardist.
Oh, really?
And we did it.
So you mixed this record in 2 days?
The first version of it. Yeah. We tweaked a bit. We tweaked eventually, but we basically got the foundation down in 2 days. We had a gun to our heads that we had to get it done. So it was, it was majorly intense.
That we later found out was a completely arbitrary gun.
Whose gun?
Wasn't my gun.
No, I think they were just trying to submit the mixes for vinyl because, you know, if you're not on a major label, you're looking at like at least 8 months or whatever it is now. It's
It's gotten better, but
I don't think so.
It's so competitive, and we had really wanted something to come out before 2023, and that was the stretch of time where we had to do it. So we just kind of made it work.
Yeah,
there was tears.
We break up every time we mix every record. But a lot of artists and bands don't necessarily need wax the day the record comes out. Or some anyway seem to exist with like, oh yeah, it'll be out in 6 months or whatever. But we couldn't really fathom that. We're very Luddites, very much so in that world, I guess. But yeah, it was a protracted process for sure, but we blazed through it as best we could. There were certain songs where we'd be in the mixing stage and we'd be like, this needs to be a semitone lower and slower, you know. So we would very speed that down, and then that would unlock a completely new bridge, you know. One of the things we stumbled onto on this record in the DAW realm was the value of loop mode. Ableton's great for that. And Pro Tools, you can work within that capacity too. But I just found when we would get the recordings back to Toronto, if you kept it on loop mode and we're soloing through tracks, invariably I'd find beautiful like reinterpretations of the existing songs that could then become an intro or an outro or a bridge or could be tracked on top of. And it just kind of expanded the scope and allowed for a little more variation. And you could kind of take a hidden layer that existed and was cooking in there, but make it the centerpiece. Yeah, that's one way technology served us anyway.
Yeah, that's cool. I mean, I think that's, you hear stories about people getting mixes back from, you know, an outside mixer that wasn't involved in the project, and they've amplified something that was kind of a, maybe even considered a secondary or tertiary part, you know, and made it the centerpiece of the song, you know, and you're like, wow, that's, you know,
it's what I imagine DJs do. I have no idea, but yeah, you just like take what sparks your interest and run with it.
Yeah. Well, with our last little bit of time, are you guys up for just talking about a few of the songs that we can just in a little more in depth? I mean, you know, Easy on Your Own. The first thing that it brought to my mind was, you know, it felt like bits of Loveless from My Bloody Valentine. It just had this undulating, warped, you know, sort of detuned feeling. There's a lot of creative sort of work went into making it interesting in the interior of these songs, you know?
About Kevin Shields was the limitations he put on his stuff. That's Mr. My Bloody Valentine.
Yep.
Like, you know, people say shoegaze, and for most people that who are familiar with it, like, think that means, oh, pedals, anything goes, reverbs, you know. But My Bloody Valentine were way more focused than that. Like, yeah, they used reverse reverb, which we did on that song, the SPX90. But, you know, for the most part, it's like he would, you know, not, it was more about the constrictions, like, okay, no chorus, no reverb, maybe no compression, like all these things. So that informed, like, broadly our approach on that song. But yeah, it went through some permutations as well. That was the oldest song, right, Mom?
Yeah, I usually feel like the older songs are the hardest to get on the record. And I don't know if that's because you're just like looking for that wow moment, and it's harder to chase, or it's harder to impress you because it's been around for so long, or you're close-minded. I don't know what it is, but at least, I mean, even in the early days with recording with Shawn, I feel like we did one early version of Easy on Your Own, and all the big moments were completely there. Like, just your initial draft of the song, it was like so inspiring, and especially like coming through your NS10s, everything just sounds incredible. And then, you know, the goal is trying to make it everything sound like NS10s after that. We get home and be like, how do we make it sound like Shawn speakers?
The chorus.
Well, most people make fun of me when they come in here and see NS10s. But we're like, that's it, that's all you got in there.
It was a shock to us when we came in too, but we immediately realized why when we pulled our demos up, and they sounded quite harsh on the NS10s, but you know, combining them with the sub is a great move. And we've since got our own pair. I think we got you on the M50 headphones, and you got us on the NS10.
Oh yeah, they definitely got me on those.
That was a cool session, though. I think we pitch bent the whole master track right before the chorus hits.
Like, oh yeah,
in Pro Tools, like dipped it, which is probably sacrilege, but it worked.
Absolutely not. you know. Well, after the earthquake is obviously like this great, I mean, it's become my favorite song recently. I just love it. It makes me feel so good when I hear this song, and it's got such great energy and sort of lovely melancholy. I would love to just hear about, you know, the writing and recording of that song and sort of its creation and all the way through a little bit. But what I think is really cool about this record is the marriage of the lyrics and the sentiment of the lyrics with the tone. And I feel like the tone of the record and the tone, the instruments, like it gives life to the words in a way that I really love. You know, there's lots of records that do that, but there are lots of records that don't. So I think that there's something magical about that marriage and the spirit of tone to sentiment in terms of like the message. Put a feeling to the words, like in terms of like how it resonates with your body, you know?
Yeah, I mean, I feel like I have such a like ringing bell voice that we spend a lot of time just trying to even balance that out. So a lot of the time I try to make the words not so sweet, or, you know, like I love the balance of Alec's really rough sounding distorted guitar, and just trying to make it, and then making it all occupy the same world is kind of hard. And even just all of the songs are so different on the record, like putting them all in one place was hard. After the Earthquake was one of the, I think, the stronger demos going into the recording process, and one of the hardest lyrically to puzzle together. But it also, because of its strength, I think in the final stretch, everything else had sort of risen above it, because it was so self-contained from the start that it took a little while to chisel that one out into making it shine the way that it kind of needed to.
Yeah, it's Earthquake sounded like it was a road song for me, and road songs are usually pretty American feeling, just because of the robust interstate system or something, I don't know, or Kerouac or what it is, but it felt like our most American song. So we really tried to go full murmur reckoning.
Wasn't built to last. I've been the first.
also trying to do like a little black and white DBs.
Yeah, yeah. All IRS records, like Jersey Jangle, sort of all East Coast stuff. And we tried to hit that mark and hopefully we got somewhere close. Shawn and I were nerding over this first video from the first spring break in Daytona where REM plays, and like you can see all kids going nuts, and they there's like 800 views on it, but all those kids go back to their college and request REM, and college rock is born. It's just a nice like formative
it's thing. Crazy the year that it's from, because it you know it's like so ahead of its time, it's insane.
Yeah, they're doing a three song showcase on the beach, and it's like Radio Free Europe and like maybe Wolves and one other tune is Gardening at Night, I'm not sure, but it just smokes. And yeah
that's an amazing story. I talked to Mitch Easter about recording Radio Free Europe, the first version of that song in his garage, and it's just such a cool story. And it's like, again, there's just tons of limitations around what they had to make the record with. And yeah, it's a great reference for the song. I didn't come to my mind, but now that you say that,
he used the prime time, didn't he? The prime time delay or something on that,
on the thing that sounds like the stick clicks.
Yeah, the very start of Radio Free Europe. Yeah, I think which Shawn had, and I think we might have used
it. Oh yeah, I think we did. It's crazy that the limitations that they were faced with, and that they probably had anxiety about when they put out that album, like now becomes like the sound of it and like part of the beauty and the nostalgia of it. Those, you know, yeah, it's like those, all those things that you think are problems end up being like the hallmark of why it's like cool.
I think that's true with a lot of classic, like kind of seminal recordings, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah. Any songs for you guys as we get into our last minutes of that kind of have, you know, special memories of tracking or recording or
the transformation of the song Pressed, which is we were trying to do basically a Smith's verse and an REM chorus, and then it sort of morphs into whatever it is by the end of the song, basically our band. But I think what you did tonally with that song, the transformation, was very cool. I just feel like you understood exactly how to make things sound like
Smith. Well, yeah, we were kind of going for, you know, well, they were going kind of going for the like a Smith's reference. I don't know if I initially realized that when we first started recording it, but when they kind of prompted that, I became like very excited about it and like trying some different kind of just experiments to get it like kind of, you know, as close as we could to kind of like that sonic footprint. I was kind of having the time of my life, really, because I've had these kind of ideas of like how to, you know, get something kind of close to a previous recording from before. And it was just like going down that wormhole to try to like, you know, A/B different tones and like the kick drum and snare and like what is happening on the snare drum in these kind of recordings to like make it feel a certain way. All these like kind of little production tricks, like getting them like all the different little things. It's like, for me, that's like heaven. Kind of playing with that is like one of the most fun things that I could possibly imagine. It's like kind of do, because if you kind of get it in that wheelhouse, and all of a sudden you kind of have a thing, and from there you can kind of expand off of it. But it's like a really fun kind of, I think it's like a good experiment for anyone who's recording to just be like, how, you know, let's model it after this, you know, other recording, and like just get as close as you can. And then like that will lead you into like a situation that maybe you didn't even realize that you'd find yourself in, you know. And it just like you kind of get something out of it that's completely different than what you would personally do. And I'm always looking to do that, where like anything that will get me away from my own brain, because I feel like I'll just do the same thing over and over again, you know, because you have a certain way that you like to hear things, but that's not the way that I want to hear things. I want to, you know, I want people to, you know, fuck with me and like, you know, make me, push me in different areas that, you know, I think that's one of the most fun things. So yeah, I feel like one of the best things to do in recording is like to try to model it after something else, because it will lead you in like a completely different area and a cool thing.
Rarely do you accomplish truly embodying somebody else's spirit, output. Yeah. It's usually some skewed perception of what you think you are and what you think something else is. I try to really draw from something directly, it never turns out that way.
Yeah, like you two thought they were trying to sound like, you know, the Joy Division, and completely like missed the mark, and they in such like a brilliant way, like, you know, they failed upwards.
Yeah, I mean, it would be impossible, right? You know, yeah. It's a really good point. I love the idea of, because, you know, we're all just filtered or lenses, you know. It's always going to be, you're not them, so it can't be that. And just like you guys know, anytime you bring something new into your band or a different person, it changes the whole composition of the molecules in the room, you know. And so it's always going to be different, and it's part of the magic of bringing the right people together, you know.
But yeah, you could get really close if you got the Smith stems and Fab Fisher. You can get pretty close.
Yeah. Taking the lid off the cauldron.
any final thoughts, other than I'm pretty sure that, you know, that Sean's mic's just not even plugged in. You didn't plug that thing in, did you?
It's been broken for like 10 years.
Yeah.
Is that the one from the guy across the street we used?
Yeah, it is the one from the guy across the street.
You broke John Lennon's mic?
Yeah. Uh-oh. No, I didn't buy it. I just happened to be, it happened to be on loan at the moment. I'm literally doing a podcast to John Lennon's microphone. Just the best for you. Speaking of it, actually, one day someone was like, just thinking of John Lennon, someone was like, can you make this song sound like Imagine? And I did this mix for them. And I personally fucking nailed that shit. Like, it was like, you could A-B it, and it sounded like the same session. Like, I was like, this is nailed. And I sent it to them, and I never heard from them ever again. And I was like, and I was like, I don't think they realize what it actually sounds like, you know? Because sometimes people will be like, oh, we want it to sound like this. And I'm like, have you listened to it? You know, like years ago, maybe like 15 years ago, someone was like, let's do like a thing that sounds like the Smiths. And I really went for it. And they were also like really disturbed by it. I mean, I feel like these guys, though, always, I mean, when they say they want it to sound like something, they know what that sounds like, you know, like you guys have actually investigated it, you know?
Yeah. Also, all the things that you find fun are the things that people are super annoyed by us about. Like,
oh yeah.
Any type of puzzle you're so excited by. Yeah. We drive everyone else crazy except for you. And I know we do drive you a little bit crazy.
No, because I thought it was like such a, like it, I think it's such a joy when you find someone that is willing to go down those roads with you, you know? And like, I feel like in my life, I'm always just looking for any creative partner that will nerd out and do cool stuff. You know what I mean? And sometimes people don't want to, you know, they don't want to do that. And like, that's like not part of the process for them, you know? And so like, it's always like a little bit of a struggle when like, for me, like that's one of the most fun things is the exploratory thing. And like, you know, sometimes they'd apologize like, oh, it's, you know, I'm sorry that we're like going down all these like wormholes. I'm like, absolutely not. Like, this is like the pure joy. Like, I'm so glad I found people that want, you know, this out of an album, you know, the same way that I do. Like, I really value those relationships when you can find people like that. Like, that's when I feel like I can fly, you know?
Yeah. The best. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Stuff. It's been really fun to talk to you both. All of you, not both. I see two screens. All three of you.
Yeah.
Make sure that John Lennon mic goes into a little magic velvet satchel of some sort.
Yeah. Plastic bag.
Yeah. All right. Yep.
All right. Thanks, guys.
See you later.
All right. See you later.
Thanks for listening. Find us online at tapeop.com, Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. Until next time.